Welcome to our webinar today. My name is Dr. Shell Watts of MBAAdmit.com. We are thrilled to be here today with the GMAT Club. Today's webinar is about how to select and shortlist target business schools. Before we get into our presentation, I wanted to tell you a little bit more about our company. MBAAdmit.com has been offering MBA admissions advising for over 30 years. We've had success with all the top 20 MBA programs in the United States, as well as the top programs in Asia and Europe. One of the more distinctive things about our company is that clients can opt to work directly with me. I have Harvard admissions experience, as well as work experience with McKinsey and Morgan Stanley. And so we leverage all that expertise to help you build outstanding applications. Here's a partial list of some of the schools that we've been very successful with. And so on to today's presentation. This will be the flow of our conversation today. I'll give you an overview of the 8 key factors for selecting and shortlisting business schools. I will then go in depth in those factors. I will show you a poorly done example, and then a well done example, and then we'll have learning and reflections. At the very end, we will offer you some special offers and let you know how to contact us in case you need assistance in your MBA admissions process. So the 8 key factors to consider as you shortlist and target business schools. These are not ordered in order of importance. These are simply 8 really important factors. Number 1, rankings and prestige. Number 2, your competitiveness. Number 3, your target industry after your MBA. Number 4, the alumni network. Number 5, the culture of the school. Number 6, the teaching method and quality of the faculty. Number 7, the locale. And number 8, student diversity. So going in depth on these top 8 factors, rankings and prestige is normally one of the first things that a candidate will think about when they start to identify schools that they want to apply to. They think of this somewhat as return on investment. So you're spending 2 years of your time as well as resources to attend this school. So of course you want to know that you will be educated very well, that you'll get great knowledge, and then also that you will have a great pedigree from the school, which will allow you to gain credibility as you move forward in your post-MBA career. So the question is, what is the difference between ranking and prestige, and how should each of these weigh in your considerations for the schools? Rankings, of course, are given out every year. There are certain organizations such as U.S. News and World Report, Fortune Magazine, and Business Week that will rank the top MBA programs, and those rankings, of course, can have fluctuations from year to year. So, for example, Harvard Business School may be ranked number 1 in year 1, and then 2 years out, it's ranked number 4, and then year 5, it's number 1 again. So those are the fluctuations in the ranking. So the question would be, if it's ranked number 4 in 1 year, does that mean that you shouldn't go there and you should take a different offer? Should you get both? That's where you start to think about also the prestige of the school. Prestige is more of a longer-term thing. It's more or less the long-term perceived ranking. If you say Harvard Business School, most people will think that that is a top business school, regardless of what other rankings might say in Fortune magazine. And so you have to always balance the two. Always keep in mind that there will be short-term fluctuations, but many of these top schools, such as Harvard and Stanford and Wharton and Columbia, have long-term prestige that you should take into great account as you target which of these business schools are attractive for you and which ones will work the most for you. Another thing that you must do is, of course, assess your competitiveness for admissions. It's not enough just to love a school. I get many candidates who say, I absolutely love Stanford, I'm an entrepreneur, I blend in that innovative environment. But it's not enough that you love Stanford. You also have to have the GPA and GMAT that will make you competitive for Stanford. So that's just part of the calculation. For many people, that's the first thing they look at is, am I at the mean or the median in terms of where matriculating students to a business school, like where their GPA and GMAT scores are. So that's a first cut that you can do, but it's really kind of complex because even if you are close to that average score on the GMAT or with your GPA, there's all sorts of other layers that the school's looking at and assessing to decide if they feel that you're a competitive candidate. So for instance, your professional record. How does that look in general? Do you have good advancement within your career? Are there any employment gaps? Are there a series of 1 year employments, which can be a problem from the view of the committee? So you need to look at your general professional record. How strong is that? There's also the issue of recommendations. It's one thing to have a great work history, but it has to be reflected through the recommendations. And so you need to be able to get the two recommendation writers that will say you're a great performer. They see great promise in you. So both of those are important in terms of knowing how competitive you'll be in terms of your professional profile. There's also the extracurricular record. Do you have some solid extracurricular activities that you've been involved in over the years? Have you shown leadership? Those are questions that you should be asking yourself as well. The leadership component is more important at some schools than others. So being a leader within your extracurricular activities is very important in terms of Harvard and in terms of Stanford. It's a little bit less important at Wharton, a little bit less important at Columbia. So it will vary by school, and you'll need to know where is it more important, where is it less important. And again, that helps you to understand your competitiveness. There is also personal story. Some people have a very strong personal story in terms of their background, or maybe challenges that they've overcome or personal achievements. And so that can also make you a lot more attractive as a candidate. You may be asking yourself, well, how will I get any sort of idea of how competitive I am? That is where a free profile evaluation might be a very good idea. We certainly offer those at MBA Admit, so feel free to contact us should you want that feedback about your competitiveness. One other thing you need to keep in mind as you're sort of going through this calculation, trying to decide if you're competitive for school, is thinking about if you're overrepresented or underrepresented. An overrepresented profile is simply one where there is a very big pool and it's very qualified, and a lot of applicants come from that pool to be applying to these top business schools. That can be a matter of an industry that you could be overrepresented in terms of industry, company, ethnicity, nationality, religion. So, for example, if someone is coming from private equity, they have a lot of people applying with private equity backgrounds. That makes you overrepresented. That may mean that when you are looking at yourself in terms of how competitive am I, when you look at that average GPA and GMAT score for matriculating students to a school, you may need to be higher than that average. In terms of a company, there are certain companies like Deloitte that send forward a lot of candidates, and the schools will only accept so many accountants. Therefore, being from Deloitte and applying may make you part of an overrepresented pool, the pool of accountants. And so that can matter. So you have to understand how that will impact you. There are some people from certain ethnicities where there's a lot of applicants, so and rather nationality as well. So if you are American of Indian descent, that's going to be a very competitive pool. If you're Indian foreign national male, that will be very competitive. If you're coming out of China, that will be also very competitive. So you need to understand that component too, because when you're overrepresented, it means that you usually may need to be a little bit higher than the average on the GPA and GMAT scores. And then if you're underrepresented, you may have more latitude to be underneath the average GPA and the average GMAT score for matriculating students. The next thing to think about, your target industry. Now, you, when you're looking at your business school, should be thinking, will this school help me advance toward my goals, my career goals? So certain questions are relevant. In what industry do you want to work? In what geographical region do you want to work? In what company do you want to work? And with all that in mind, you need to ask yourself, will this school facilitate access, preparation, and advancement for me in my career? Another question, do target employers recruit heavily from the school? You want to know that if you know, have your heart set on consulting, that consultants come to the school, they recruit heavily, and that it might be an easier path for you to get that first job out of business school. If you're not already in an industry, will the school facilitate your transition? That's also a very relevant question. So think about your target industry that you're looking to enter or re-enter after business school, and ask yourself some of these questions that can help you target schools and help you shortlist them as well. The next thing to think about, alumni network. Now, when you think about the alumni network, you have to remember this. You'll be at the school, sorry about that, You'll be at the school for, on average, about 2 years. Some of the programs are 18 months and 1 year, but most of them are 2 years. So you're going to be there for 2 years, but this investment in the MBA will last your lifetime. So you're going to be inheriting a lifetime network, and there are certain things that make an alumni network valuable. So what should you be thinking about that in terms of assessing the strength of this with the school that you're looking at, and how well will the alumni network work for you in the longer term? Size, how extensive is the alumni network? Location, where is it located? If you intend to go abroad back to Europe to work, you need to consider, will the alumni network at the business school that you're targeting, so say that's a US school, is there a good strong presence in Europe or not? And that might affect whether that school is very attractive to you, whether it should be on your short list. Industry presence. Are there abundant or influential alumni members in your target industry? Both of those components are important. So there's influence, and there's also a number of alumni members in your target industry. Even if there aren't a lot of alumni, if they are very influential, that will make a difference. But it's also great to have a lot of alumni members in your target industry. So think about that, and think about how that should factor into the schools that you're targeting. And then finally, the organization and the culture of the alumni network. How organized is the alumni network? This potentially, the alumni network potentially can be a source for you for continuing education if they are highly organized, if they run panels, if they have networking events. Those all can be valuable things for you moving forward in the future. Another question, is it known for supportiveness? Because you want to know that if you pick up the phone and call a fellow alumni member, that the culture is one that encourages that person to take the call, to try to assist you with whatever you might need, answer your queries if you have some. So what is the culture of the alumni network? All those should be part of what you're assessing as you are looking at a school and deciding, should you target it? Should it be on your short list? School culture. Now, for some people, this matters more than others. Some people have the mindset that even if I don't really like the culture that much, I'm willing to sort of, suffer it out for 2 years just to get my degree from that school. Other people think, I want to really enjoy this. I want to make sure I fit in and enjoy myself. And by the way, since this is a lifetime commitment, I want to make sure I blend with the alumni members as well. So culture is bigger for them. So some of the things that you can think about when you're thinking about school culture are, competitiveness versus collaborative. Does it matter? Some people want to be in a highly collaborative environment. Some people don't mind if it's more competitive. Wharton is known for having a more competitive culture where there's more competition among its students. Columbia is known for being more collaborative. So you should get to know the schools and understand what the cultures are. There's conservative versus laid back. Stanford, of course, is ca in California. Entrepreneurship is there, innovation is valued. It's got a much more laid back feel than a place like Chicago Booth. You have hardcore versus soft in how the business school feels. There are some business schools that are known for being hardcore finance. There are others that are more focused on social entrepreneurship. They will have a softer feel. So Yale is an example of the softer feeling business school because it focuses so much on social entrepreneurship. So Yale is good for people who want that feel of a school, whereas someone coming from investment banking may not like that feel. Techie versus not. MIT is known for being a very techie school. Some people find that extremely attractive, others will not. So you need to bear that in mind. There's rigorous versus boot camp. There is a difference between an environment being challenging and one where you just feel you're under a lot of pressures. Very intense, and you're constantly working. So figure out which schools have the boot camp reputation. If that's not what the experience that you're looking for, then move toward ones that have a reputation for being perhaps rigorous but not boot camp in the field. And then finally, overemphasis on many versus not. Harvard Business School is actually known for emphasizing money a lot. A lot of my candidates who've gone to Harvard have felt that once they got there, they kind of lost a little bit of sight of their dreams, and they were focused only on how much will my salary be once I leave and how much money will I make in my first 5 years. And it took them a little bit of time to come back to focusing on their dreams. So That's not true of all candidates. It is true of some candidates who've gone to the school. Other schools are known to not have that sort of issue that students have to face. So again, do your homework, talk to students, talk to alumni members, understand the culture, and that can help you to shortlist the school. And then finally, number six, as we move through to our last three of the eight, how will you learn best? Everyone is different, and you will know that what your style is. Do you like a lot of experiential learning? Do you want more of a case method where you're in the classroom debating topics? Are you interested in an immersion program? Capstone projects and school year internships are components that some schools offer. And then some schools are absolutely fantastic with just doing a wonderful blend of each of these. So understand, how do you best learn? What are you looking for in an experience in terms of the teaching approach? Do your homework with each of the schools, and then you can use that also to target and narrow down your list. Locale can actually influence not only your personal happiness, but also potentially your career opportunities after your MBA experience. So think about the relevant factors, large city versus small town. Some people know they will go crazy in a small town. They really need the bustle of a big city, and so that can help you weed off some of the schools that you might have been looking at. And then there's urban versus rural. The same thing. Some people really want that urban setting. Other people will find the rural more peaceful. Region of the world. In the United States, you have to just decide, where do you want to be? So if you're an American and you plan to maybe have your career in the South, and you also know that you blend in the South, then maybe that's an attractive place to be looking for your top choices. For other people, you may feel that California has more of the culture that you're looking for, not only to go to school, but also to have your early career. And so regions should affect your choice. The business emphasis of the surrounding cities should also be a factor. There are some people who absolutely love entrepreneurship and are very sure that that's what they will do after the MBA. And so you may want to choose a city that is known to have a high concentration of entrepreneurial companies. You know, people love Silicon Valley when they are entrepreneurs, and so that means maybe take a look at Haas and take a look at Stanford. The same thing with tech, and same thing with finance. People in finance, many people gravitate toward New York and will be looking at schools in or near New York, such as Columbia or Wharton. The next thing is student diversity. Some people have this as a very important factor, and others don't, as they're looking through the schools. But you need to ask yourself, what kind of student environment do you want? Does it matter to you if it's ethnically diverse? If you are from a particular ethnicity, do you want a large percentage of folks from your own ethnic background there? And if so, do your homework about statistics. Some people want to have a really good gender balance. Others aren't even thinking about that. International diversity is important to some candidates. Industry diversity is important for some. College major diversity, that just might mean that you're getting a richer blend of perspectives in the classroom. Age diversity, there are some people who are older, who might be 32, who really don't want to go to a school where most of the students are between 25 and 27. They're going to feel like that's maybe a bit too young, and so they're looking more for age diversity. And then there's also people who would like to be a part of a broader university, and so they may want a diversity of students within that broader university. And so for someone who is going to go to business school but wants to be free to take a class at the education school or a public policy school, that candidate would be looking at certain universities that are a part, business schools that are part of a broader university that has either a large college or different graduate schools nearby. There are other factors to consider. These are important based on your profile, but sensitivity to age is actually one of the more important on this list. There are some schools that are top 10 that are not very receptive to older candidates. And so if you are 32, at some schools that could mean an automatic rejection. Schools like Harvard and Stanford are known for preferring much younger candidates. And so you need to know which ones are sensitive to your age and which ones are very open regardless of your age. There's also the length of the program. Some people only want a one-year program. Some people are fine for both, and others only want a two-year. And so that will also help you weed out potential schools. And then there's how receptive is the school to your professional background. There are some candidates who are non-traditional. So say the teacher, a teacher applying to business school, not all top 10 schools or top 20 schools are going to be receptive to that. Some are more receptive than others, and you need to understand which ones are very receptive to you and make sure some of those are on your short list. There are other non-traditional background candidates. It could be a nurse, it could be a doctor applying. It's really anything that's not mainstream business. You need to understand how receptive is your target school to that sort of background. And then finally, there's expense that some candidates don't want to, you know, get into too much debt. And so if there is a $60,000 difference between school A and school B, that will matter to them in terms of which one will they choose. And so take a look at what is the tuition and does it matter to you any difference in the pricing that you're looking at between the schools. So let's go through a poorly done example. There's a candidate who is male, 32 years old, 660 GMAT score, 3.8 GPA, American of Indian descent, a teacher, and his long-term goals were to start a nationwide chain of charter schools. Now, this candidate has certain challenges in his profile that he should have, you know, had front and center in his mind as he shortlisted schools. There are, as I said, some schools that will not really entertain a 32-year-old and will feel that that person is outside of their desired range of ages for their students. And there are some schools that will look at this candidate and say 660 is, first of all, beneath our average, and secondly, for your profile, American of Indian descent, that pool of candidates tends to have very high GMAT scores, and so that GMAT score will look doubly low in that pool. And so those are two very big challenges that this candidate has. He's also non-traditional, being a teacher and wanting to start charter schools. So those should have been factors that he used to funnel out schools. He had 8 schools of interest. He actually only applied. He applied on his own to 2 schools, Harvard and Stanford. That was not a prudent approach. And his results was that the results came in and they were rejected. He was rejected at both of those schools, no interviews at either one. So that would not have been our advice to him about how to approach these schools. Even though he is a long shot, we never tell people don't apply where you want to apply. We always say put your best application together and let the school decide. If this candidate had had a stronger application, maybe he could have gotten in, maybe not. But he was cut largely on age and GMAT score, in our opinion. He came to us after that wanting to apply the very next round, so did not want to wait a whole another year to find out about Harvard and Stanford and whether he could get in on a second try with a stronger application. So we, with the age in mind, said, look, what would make you competitive, where you would be potentially competitive, are Wharton, Columbia, Booth, Yale, Duke, and University of Texas. We've had many 32-year-olds get admission into Wharton, so we know that that's not by itself what will end a candidacy to Wharton. But the non-traditional education in his background and where he wants to go, that is more of an issue for some schools. And so with that in mind, we would say de-emphasize Booth. They're not really known for going after the candidate that's very non-traditional. Being a teacher was non-traditional. And then with the GMAT score in mind, we also knew that that would make Wharton very hard because 660 is definitely beneath their average and for his pool, very low. So we knew that would be a very long shot. So we honed in on Columbia, Yale, Duke, and University of Texas. With a well-timed application, he got his admissions at Columbia, Yale, and Duke. He actually didn't end up applying to University of Texas, and we were thrilled to see that he did get admissions to these other 3. So let's take a look at a well-done example. Now, this candidate I chose because she was somewhat similar to the other candidate we just looked at in terms of age and GMAT score. So female, 32 years old, 680 GMAT score, 3.5 GPA. She's from West Africa. She had 4 years of working with a top New York investment bank in New York, which was made her very unusual in the sense that she was a citizen of a West African country working in the United States at a top New York investment bank. So that made her profile very unique. On top of that, she had 3 years of entrepreneurship experience in Africa, and her long-term goal was to scale her company, make it larger, more successful. So with the eight factors in mind, we know that, again, there are some challenges on the profile. 32 years old means that some schools are a bit more sensitive. 680 on the GMAT score will make her underneath the average at some of the top schools. And so we said, look, we're not saying don't apply to Harvard and Stanford, but we know the preference there is for younger candidates. And so apply where you have a solid shot: Columbia, Duke, Wharton. Wharton would be a little bit harder because of the 680 GMAT score, but it was still a possibility. So we said, in terms of working with us, why don't we focus on those schools? We went forward with that strategy and essentially just focused in on those schools, prepared extra hard for Wharton because we knew that the interview would be very important for her. Wharton has a group interview, unlike some other schools, and so it is a little bit more of a difficult and challenging interview, so we prepped her very well for that. We also had her take some additional online courses for Wharton so that she had other things to show them besides the 3.5 GPA, which was pretty much at the average, but given that her GMAT was lower, we wanted a little bit more of a push on the academic credentials. She had great outcomes. She got into Columbia, she got into Wharton, and she had no need to apply elsewhere. So we were really happy with that outcome. It was a very well done strategy. So learnings and reflections. We would just say keep the eight main factors in mind. You might start with a list of 10 to 12 schools, and think about from there with the eight factors in mind, where are you competitive? Funnel it down to, you know, ones where you have a good mix. You know, it's very important to have a good mix. Two safety schools, perhaps. It's fine to have some dream schools in there as well. But if your goal is to go to school the very next year, you want to have a couple safety schools, ones that are pretty sure shots, and then others where you're more comfortable, and then a couple reach in there if you want as well. So put that all together. You should have a good strategy put in place, time your applications well, and hopefully you'll get some outcomes with which you are very happy. All right, so it was wonderful to be with you today on this webinar. Here is some more information. We're definitely inviting you to come and get a free profile evaluation. Just go to our website. There's a profile evaluation form right on the homepage. You can also send us your resume instead, and we can give you feedback on that basis. We are offering a $150 discount off of our gold comprehensive package. Just mention the code GCL417. That's good for a couple more weeks. Feel free to sign up for our newsletter. We will send out information and insights to you that can help you prepare for your MBA admissions journey. And here is our contact information. So again, feel free to be in touch. We're wishing you the very best in your MBA journey, and reach out to us if you find out that you need some assistance as you go along. Thanks for joining us today.